We are ready to go with Full English number 21. Yes, you heard me right. Full English number 21. Action. Hi everybody, this is Mr. Duncan in England. How are you today? Are you okay? I hope so. Are you happy? I hope so. Oh, I haven't said that for such a long time. Do you remember when I used to introduce every video lesson like that? Anyway, welcome to another full English lesson. Yes, I have decided to make another one. Just in case you were thinking that the previous one was the last ever. Of course, the name of the game is Teaching English in England. That is where I am. England also happens to be the birthplace of Sherlock Holmes, James Bond. Harry Potter, Obi-Wan Kenobi, Oliver Twist, Mary Poppins, Danger Mouse. Come to think of it, I don't think any of those people are real. I think they are fictitious. They are made-up characters. They don't really exist, except in our imagination. Oh, I seem to have strayed a little off topic here, so before I get any further off the rails, let's get back on track by beginning today's full English lesson right now. Can you see what I have here? This is a plug. It forms part of many electrical devices and safely allows electricity to travel from the mains outlet to the device in question. You plug this into the mains outlet or socket. The verb for this action is also plug. You plug it in. I forgot to plug the TV in. You need to plug it in before it will work. To take the plug out is unplug. You unplug something. Don't forget to unplug the TV before you come to bed. You will have to unplug the washing machine before moving it. To plug is to connect, and to unplug is to disconnect. The word plug can also be something used to block a hole. It can be a noun or verb. I'm going to plug the hole. The word plug can also mean to informally mention something as a way of advertising it to others. I will be on the radio today to plug my new book. Could you plug my new song on your show? In these sentences, the word plug means to casually mention something so as to promote it. One of the hardest parts of teaching any subject is to ensure that you successfully impart the information to your students. To impart is to pass on information. You convey the information contained in the subject you are teaching. To teach is to impart. But that process can only be achieved when the students understand what it is you are teaching them. It is very tempting to use big words and complicated sentences when teaching. It is possible to be too esoteric in your teaching. The word esoteric means to say something in a way that only certain people will understand. New teachers often want to show off their newly acquired skill
by going too deeply into their subject. A teacher should always strive to explain something complex in a simple way, especially when their students are new to the subject. I like to do a bit of both in my explanations. Sometimes I will throw in a new word, but at the same time I will explain it, so as to allow the penny to drop. When the penny drops, this means that the person understands what you are saying. This idiom shows that the information has been passed on successfully. It is now understood. I understand what you mean now, Mr. Duncan. The penny has dropped. Do you want to know what I'm doing here? I am about to change a light bulb. The bulb inside this light fitting has blown. It has burned itself out. It has come to the end of its life. It is no longer working. The bulb has gone. In this sense, the word gone means expired. The bulb is dead. So I will now replace the blown one with one that works. First, I need to make sure that the electricity is turned off, so I don't electrocute myself, because that would really spoil my day and make this lesson very short. Have you noticed how many types of light fittings there are nowadays? Some push in, some screw in, and as for their shapes, some bulbs are spherical, some bulbs are curly, and some are straight and long. We measure the light output of bulbs in watts. This particular bulb is 40 watts. It is a 40 watt bulb. Okay, it's time to change that light bulb. I must unscrew the bulb carefully so as not to break it.
Strange. Somebody's turned the power supply to the lights off.
First, I need to make sure that the electricity is turned off.
Okay.
The electricity is turned off.
Okay.
So I don't electrocute myself, electrocute myself, electrocute myself.
I think I will turn that back on.
And you thought you were having a bad day.
Mr. Lomax! Help!
What's that? It sounds like Mr. Duncan's in trouble. I'm coming, Mr. Duncan.
Mummy, read me a bedtime story. You promised me, you said you would. You promised me, if I was good, read me a story. Mummy.
Mr. Duncan, are you all right?
Wait a minute. When I was standing up there, I had different clothes on. I was wearing a grey tank top over a purple shirt. Now I'm wearing a black jumper. Oh, I know what's happened. There has been some bad continuity. The clothes I wore in the previous shots do not match the ones I'm wearing now. They have changed. This is bad continuity. The flow of this sequence has been
broken by this mistake. You sometimes see bad continuity in TV shows and movies. This is mainly caused by the fact that each shot is done at different times or in completely different places. So sometimes it is possible for them not to match. Continuity errors can be seen in all types of productions, from the low-budget movie right up to the multi-million-dollar blockbuster. See what I'm pushing here? It's a very useful piece of garden apparatus. A handy thing to have about when you have large loads and heavy objects to move around. This is a wheelbarrow. You will often see builders and gardeners pushing one of these around. You can transport heavy and cumbersome things safely in a wheelbarrow. You can put garden debris, such as dead leaves and pulled up weeds, into a wheelbarrow, so they can be taken away and disposed of more conveniently. On building sites, you will often see wheelbarrows used for moving heavy material, such as cement or bricks, from one place to another. A wheelbarrow typically has one central wheel, which can either be air-filled or solid. This particular wheelbarrow has been designed to be lightweight, while at the same time robust and sturdy. This is what makes the wheelbarrow an essential tool for making those heavy-duty jobs much easier to carry out. But be careful not to overfill it, or it might tip over, leaving you with an even... Here's a word that seems to be pronounced one way, but is in fact pronounced another. The word is cumulative. The first syllable of this word sounds like the letter Q. The word cumulative is an adjective and means increasing or increased in quantity, degree, or force by successive additions. For example, the addition of other things over time creates a cumulative effect. We often talk about a cumulative effect when discussing health issues, the damage caused to the human body by years of poor diet and neglect can be described as being cumulative. We often talk about the cumulative effect on the environment caused by steady ecological neglect. A cumulative effect normally occurs over a period of time, sometimes over many years. The process of accumulation is cumulative, accumulating, growing, progressive, accruing, snowballing, mounting. Poor health in middle age is seen as being caused by cumulative neglect. We can also use the word accumulative in this way too. We use punctuation in writing to show the tense of each sentence and how it should be read. To do this, we use punctuation marks. However, some punctuation marks can cause confusion. A good example being the differences between a colon and semicolon in English. They look very similar, hence the confusion. First of all, a colon is used so as to indicate that a list is about to begin. Information that is given in list form often has a colon placed just before it begins. A colon is also used just before a quote or when an explanation is given. If you are expanding the explanation of a subject in a sentence, then you might use a colon there too. You will normally see a colon used when a particular time has been written down in numerical form. The proportion between two numbers is usually separated by a colon, like this. The semicolon is used in a sentence to show that a pause is taking place. The semicolon pause is longer than a comma. It gives a natural break in a sentence without ending it. You will often see a semicolon used between main clauses. Words that express a sentence in singular form are usually separated by semicolons. A semicolon provides a natural break between words that would otherwise look odd together. You might say that the semicolon performs a similar function as that of the dash. So, to recap, a colon is used when starting a list or when expanding a sentence or before a quotation. A semicolon is used so as to show a pause or mark a division between main clauses. Colon. Semicolon. Whenever we talk about something being subjective, what are we actually saying? Well, the word subjective is often used when discussing opinions and points of view. We often refer to the subjective nature of something. The word subjective relates to each individual's view or perception of something that can be translated in many ways. A good example of this occurs when talking about art. A painting or drawing of something might be interpreted in many ways. When we look at a piece of art, we often try to work out what its meaning is. What is the artist trying to convey? What are they expressing? Of course, one person's interpretation might differ from others. There might be many ways of looking at this particular piece of artwork. So in this case, we can say that the views are all subjective. Each view expressed is a personal point of view. So any opinion expressed concerning a topic or issue can be described as being subjective. It is an individual point of view. It is a personal opinion. It is open for debate. It is subjective. Well, it looks as if my time is up for today. Sadly, that is all I have time for today. It's time for me to skedaddle. That means I must go away. But don't worry, because I will be back very soon, so feel free to click around until the next time we meet here on the super duper internet highway, when our paths shall cross again. This is Mr. Duncan in the birthplace of the English language, that is of course England, saying thank you for watching me teaching you, and of course, ta-ta for now.